your case.
Okay, ma'am. A 25-year-old primary gravita named P. Sneha, with 8 months period of gestation, a resident of Alipuram, Vizag, a housewife, has come for regular antenatal checkups and is identified with elevated blood sugar levels. Her last menstrual period was on 14th February 2019. Expected date of delivery, when calculated, it is 21st November 2019. The period of gestation was 34 weeks. She has regular cycles. History of present illness: she was perceiving active fetal movements. She has increased frequency of micturition since 1 month. No labor pains, no history of bleeding or draining for PV, no burning micturition is present.
Okay.
Obstetric history. Yes, ma'am. Okay, ma'am. First trimester history: she conceived spontaneously. It was confirmed by urine pregnancy test. She was taking folic acid from 3rd month. Dating scan is done. History of fever with rash. No history of burning micturition. No excessive vomiting. Second trimester.
Any investigations done during the first two trimester?
Yes, ma'am. Dating scan is done, ma'am, and regular antenatal checkups like RBS, HB, HBS, AG, HIV, and.
Are they available? The test reports are available.
We haven't seen the reports, ma'am.
Reports. So, is it important or not?
Yes, ma'am.
In what way it is important? Dating scan.
Any comorbid? Yes, ma'am.
Dating scan was done. So, is it important or not?
Yes, ma'am. To know.
So,
yes, ma'am.
To confirm the exact period of gestation, it is important. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Any other investigations that are important? Because here you admitted the patient with in view of high blood sugars. So past records are also important, whether it was confirmed previously or not. So any blood sugars?
No, ma'am. She does not have a previous blood sugar history.
Not done. So not available. Records are not available or not done.
Not available, ma'am.
Okay. Not available.
HbA1c also we have checked.
HbA1c done.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. It was 7 or 7, ma'am. The value range from 7. No history of fever with rash, no history of burning micturition, no excessive vomiting, and no bleeding PV. Second trimester history: 2 doses of TT vaccination has taken. She's taking iron, folic acid, and calcium tablets since 4th month. TFA scan done, and no anomalies are found. Quickenings felt for the first time in 6th month. No pedal edema, headache, blurring of vision, or epigastric pain. No bleeding or draining PV.
So, any blood investigations in the second trimester?
Repetition of random blood sugar test, ma'am.
Is it random blood sugar is important or some other test is important? Why random blood sugar is important? What are the screening tests for diabetes, gestational diabetes, and pregnancy?
Yes, random oral glucose tolerance test and the HbA1c, ma'am.
HbA1c and oral. When will you do?
Oral.
At what period of gestation will you do?
as soon as the pregnancy is confirmed, first test is done, one screening test is done.
Why? And what is the importance of screening or universal screening? What is the importance of universal screening? Why we are doing?
India is a diabetic capital of
India, diabetic so, capital. So, India almost, it's more.
Yes, one it should be. Unless and otherwise proven, we must suspect if the pregnant lady might be diabetic. So screening is test done for all the pregnant women as soon as pregnancy is confirmed.
At first antenatal visit itself, you must do the. Otherwise, what will happen? Usually, in other countries or in WHO recommendations, it is 24 to 28 weeks of gestation. So what will happen if you delay the test?
If we delay the test, the organogenesis will be affected if she has diabetes.
So if she has a previous history of overt diabetes, so we may yes, miss the congenital anomalies. What more complications we may miss? What are the other complications? She may land in preterm labor or premature rupture of the membranes.
Yes.
So okay. Universal screening at the time of first antenatal visit, it is more important. Okay, proceed. So what are the different tests available for the screening?
Different tests screening.
What are the screening tests? You are telling that oral glucose tolerance test. So oral OGTT also, there are different methods. Which method India is following?
One-step oral glucose tolerance test.
Single-step oral glucose tolerance test. How will you do?
Irrelevant of the meals she has taken. 75 grams of glucose is given to the patient. And after 2 hours, the blood sugar levels are noted irrespective of the diet she has taken before.
Ask her to take glucose directly? You ask her to eat the glucose?
No, ma'am. It should be mixed in water solution.
Diluted in at least 300 ml of water. 300 ml of water. Ask her to take and after... how much time you wait?
After 2 hours, madam.
After 2 hours. What is the cutoff point?
Cutoff point. Of
126, ma'am. No, 2 hours glucose tolerance test. 140 is the cutoff point. 140.
Okay.
140 or more, it indicates definitely diagnosis of gestational diabetes. 120 to 139 is glucose intolerance. They are at risk. If it is negative, it is less than 100 like that, or it is less than 120. So what will you do?
Repeat the test at 24 to 28 weeks, in between 24 to 28 weeks.
So you repeat the test at 24 to 28 weeks of gestation. If it is again negative, again you can do it 32 to 34 weeks. Because after 24 weeks, the incidence of gestational diabetes is almost 60%. Before 24 weeks, 20 to 30%. So if you do the test at 24 to 28 weeks, you may miss the remaining 40%. That's why universal screening is very important in our population. What are the other tests? Other tests. IADPSC. International Diabetic in Pregnancy Society.
DIPSI, American Association.
not American is not we are not following. We are following either DIPSI or IADPSC. IADPSC is International Association Diabetes and Pregnancy Society Group. There also we will give 75 grams of glucose. First hour is fasting is how much in that group? 92 milligrams. First hour is 180 and second hour is
150.
That is the cutoff point in the test. But here it is only 140 milligrams in DIPSI. So our Indian government and WHO following the DIPSI only. Okay.
Okay, ma'am.
Next. So in the second trimester, no screening was done. Okay. So TIFA is now. In the third trimester.
TIFA scan is done, ma'am, in second trimester.
TIFA done. Okay.
Third trimester history. She is perceiving active fetal movements. Growth scan was done in 7th month and reports was normal. Increased frequency of menstruation is seen. No pedal edema or blurring of vision and epigastric pain. No bleed or draining PV is seen.
Okay.
Gynecological history, ma'am. Age of menarche is 12 years.
So gynecological history normal. Previous menstrual history, what family history is important, what personal history is important in this patient?
Family history, previous any family persons with previous diabetes, we should ask, ma'am. History of twins or congenital malformations in any children in the family. Or polyhydramnios baby. A big baby in a family is also a positive family history.
Main history is diabetes in the family, both parents and siblings, any near relatives, like grandparents.
Yes, ma'am.
This history is more important. Okay. Next, hypertension. Personal history?
Personal history. Personal history, she takes mixed diet, sleep and appetite are normal. Bubble and bladder movements are normal. She is non-smoker and non-alcoholic, ma'am.
Okay, okay.
No history of hypertension, diabetes, asthma, tuberculosis, epilepsy, thyroid or cardiac diseases, ma'am. No history of surgery.
What is the age of this patient?
25-year-old, ma'am.
25 years, okay. What is the marital life? How many years?
2 years of marital life.
Okay, 2 years of spontaneous conception. Okay.
Yes, ma'am. No history of surgeries in the past, no history of blood transfusion or no drug allergies for the patient. General examination, she's conscious, coherent and cooperative. She's moderately built and nourished. Pallor is present, no icterus, cyanosis, clubbing, lymphadenopathy or pedal edema. Spine, breast, thyroid are normal. Gait is normal. Vitals, ma'am. Temperature febrile. Pulse rate is 82 beats per minute with normal rhythm, volume and character. Blood pressure is 120 by 80 mmHg. Seen in right arm in sitting position. Respiratory rate 16 per breaths per minute.
So, what more you need? What you missed in general examination, you missed one thing.
Anemic, I have written pallor. She's
so
anemic.
Okay, that's all said. What is the weight of the patient?
Weight of the patient, we haven't seen weight, ma'am.
But you must take the weight. What is the importance of the weight?
Weight, obesity, diabetes, type 2.
Even GDM also common in obese patients.
Yes, ma'am.
So you must calculate the BMI.
BMI, yes.
How you calculate the BMI?
Weight by height in meters square.
Meters square. What is the normal BMI?
18.5 to 24.5.
Nine. Very good. Overweight?
Overweight 25 to 29.9.
Obesity.
About 30 BMI, ma'am.
Obesity. So obesity also above 30. Sometimes grades are there in obesity. What are the grades? Grade 1 is more than 30. Grade 2 is 30 to 35. Grade 3 is 35 to 34. Grade 4 is more than 40 or more than 35 with comorbidities like hypertension, renal disease, hyperlipidemias. These are all. Even with 35, more than 35 with comorbidities also, it comes under obesity grade 4. Why obesity is important in this patient? You diagnosed as she's having high sugar levels. So what way BMI is important? One is for suspicion and diagnosis. Other is for management. You adjust the calories according to the BMI. How much intake, how much carbohydrate intake, you must adjust depending upon the weight of the patient. So that's why in every pregnant lady, weight is very important. So that's why in every, what is a normal weight gain?
12 to 14 kilos, ma'am.
In a normal patients or underweight patients, it's okay. But in the normal, it is 9 to 11 cases. Normal ladies. Underweight, it is more 12 to 16 cases. Up to 12, it's okay. So, how you manage the patient? What advice you give? What is the amount of weight? Usually, half kg per week. But in these patients, higher weight gain is very dangerous. That's why you minimize the weight, especially in obese ladies. You minimize the weight up to 6 kgs throughout pregnancy, not more than 6 kgs, especially in diabetics and obese patients. You must reduce the weight gain. So rapid weight gain is not dangerous in these patients. That's why initial weight and weight gain is very important in these patients. So, in the general examination, in this patient, BMI is very, very important. Next, abdominal examination.
Obstetric exam. Inspection, ma'am. Abdomen is distended, flank fullness is absent, all quadrants are moving.
You can tell the salient. You tell the salient points, any points. Any abnormal findings? Is it corresponding to the gestational age?
No, ma'am. Height
of uterus corresponding to the
more than
What are the reasons for height is more than period of gestation? One is big baby.
Baby polyhydramnios, madam.
Very good, polyhydramnios.
I don't know.
It may be multi-fetal gestation. Very good. Twin gestation. Very good. Somebody giving a hint. Wrong dates. But here, dating scan is present. Otherwise, wrong dates. When you examine the patient with the full bladder, when you examine the patient with the full bladder also, height is more. Any masses like ovarian mass, any ovarian tumor or fibroid, complicating pregnancy also, height of the uterus is more than. So in our case, it may be big baby or polyhydramnios, or you examine the patient with the full bladder. Next. So what is your diagnosis?
Diagnosis is from 25-year-old primary with a period of gestation 34 weeks with pallor, increased frequency of micturition since 1 month, has come to the hospital for regular antenatal checkups and was found to have raised blood glucose levels, that is 150 milligrams per deciliter, which was detected for the first time in pregnancy with no previous history of diabetes, which is suggestive of a case of gestational diabetes.
By which test it is 150 milligrams, you not mentioned clearly, found to have raised blood sugar. Is it random blood sugar, fasting blood sugar, or a GCT, oral glucose challenge test?
Oral glucose challenge test.
They did that 34 weeks of gestation, first time?
Yes, ma'am.
First time they did the test, it found to be 150 milligrams. So it's a case of gestational diabetes. How can you say it is gestational diabetes? It is not a overt diabetes.
She does not have any symptoms of diabetes like polydipsia.
She's having polyuria in this patient. Polyuria is present,
ma'am. But only since it is only since 1 month, ma'am. So
only
might be due
month.
To the yes.
Present diabetes. So she may presented with polyuria. So if it is 200, more than 200, then
it is overt diabetes, ma'am.
Then it is overt diabetes. So how can you detect overt diabetes in early weeks? So you are doing universal screening in the first antenatal visit or first trimester. How can you differentiate whether it is a gestational diabetes or it is a overt diabetes? Is it important to differentiate?
Yes, ma'am. Because in over diabetic patients, only insulin therapy should be given, ma'am.
No need. Diabetes also, you can give medical therapy. If it is a mild diabetes, even overt also, you can give oral hypoglycemic agents. So how you differentiate?
A1C levels might be helpful, ma'am. No complaints of diabetes in the past?
No need. By investigation, if you do the fasting blood sugar, if it is more than 92 and less than 126 millimeters, it is a gestational diabetes.
Yes.
Okay? If fasting blood sugar is more than 126 millimeters and the HbA1c is 6.5, in early weeks, suggests overt diabetes. Or postprandial blood sugar more than 200, it is a overt diabetes. Okay, you got the point?
Yes, ma'am.
Repeat, what is the fasting blood sugar in GDM?
Madam?
In GDM, what is the fasting blood sugar?
Fasting 125, ma'am.
More than 92, less than 126.
Okay.
More than 92, less than 126. Or by dipsy, it is more than 140.
Okay.
Or fasting blood sugar more than 126 is overt diabetes. By dipsy, it is more than 200 overt diabetes. Okay.
Okay.
Now it is already 150 milligrams. You diagnosed as a gestational diabetes mellitus. How you manage this patient?
Medical nutritional therapy should be given. And exercises are to be prescribed, ma'am. Regular blood sugar levels have to be checked.
So, what are the different types of management?
Nutritional therapy.
So medical nutritional therapy, MNT.
no. And
second one, and
exercises, ma'am. Exercises or brisk walking.
Those are all MNT. Medical nutrition therapy along with exercise and.
Yes, ma'am. Then oral hypoglycemic drugs, ma'am.
Second one is oral or insulin. So, what is meant by MNT? What is the main purpose of all these things? MNT or oral hypoglycemic drugs, insulin. What is the importance? What is your goal?
To avoid the spikes in the rise of blood sugar levels at once, it should be avoided.
So proper glycemic targets to achieve proper glycemic control so that the complications of diabetes you can avoid. So how much is the glycemic control you need in GDM?
Goals are fasting blood sugar 70 to 95, ma'am. One hour postprandial is less than 140. 2 hour postprandial is less than 120. HbA1c levels could be less than 6.5, ma'am.
Less than 5.3 in GDM.
Okay.
Our fasting blood sugar less than 92 and postprandial blood sugar less than 100. 120, okay. Less than 120. You can remember like that also.
Okay.
We are daily or alternate days, we are doing fasting blood sugar and postprandial, 2 hours post meal. That is less than 120 and fasting is less than 92. Like that you remember. In GDM. If it is already over to diabetes, then it is pre-meal less than 90, 1 hour post-meal 140, and 2 hours post-meal 120. There also 90-120. Okay? In both cases, even tired. But here in the type 2 diabetes, HbA1c less than 6. Okay?
Okay.
So, what is meant by MNT? How you advise the diet?
Specific
what is the daily requirement? What is the daily requirement?
For normal weight woman, it is 30 kilocalories per kg, ma'am. Overweight woman, 24 kilocalories per kg, and obese woman 12 kilocalorie per kg body weight.
So total in an ideal weight person 1800 to 2400 kilocalories per day. How much is the carbohydrate?
Carbohydrate should be 50%, protein 20%, and fat should be 25 to 30% range.
How you distribute the meal plan?
Three snackings, ma'am.
Three major meals. What will happen if you give a major meal in the morning? So these three major meals also you can divide into 2, 2, 2. So that you can adjust total portions into 9 portions. Okay?
Okay, ma'am.
Breakfast also, you can divide into 2 spells. Afternoon, lunch also, you can divide into 2. So that sudden rise of glucose in the body, you can reduce. Okay?
Okay.
So, how long you wait?
For 2 weeks, we should inspect. After 2 weeks, test should be done.
Which test you do?
Blood sugar levels.
Fasting blood sugar less than 90 and postprandial blood sugar less than 120.
Yes, ma'am.
If there is no control, what will you do?
then we should shift to oral hypoglycemic drugs or insulin.
What are the oral hypoglycemic drugs available?
Metformin and the glibenclamide.
So which group it comes, metformin? It is a biguanide. Yes, Renu Bhargavi answered. It is biguanide. So what is the mechanism of action of the metformin? You know, very good inhibition. It inhibits the, it decreases the hepatic gluconeogenesis. Okay,
ma'am.
It increases the uptake of peripheral tissues like muscle and adipose tissues. So it increases the uptake, and it also decreases the absorption of the glucose.
Okay.
By that, it maintains the glycemic control. What is the action of the glibenclamide? What is the mechanism of action of glibenclamide? In what way it helps? In which group? It is a sulfonylurea group of drug.
Okay.
Very good. Deepika answers. It acts by. It increases the insulin secretion. What is the main defect in gestational diabetes, Amma? What is the main defect?
Insulin resistance, ma'am.
One is insulin resistance. Second one is decreased insulin secretion.
Okay.
Insulin secretion may be low or insulin resistance is more. Why insulin resistance is more in pregnancy?
Due to the effect of pregnancy hormones like estrogen, placental lactogen, progesterone. These hormones,
cortisol. So these are all they increase the resistance of the insulin. Even in the normal pregnancy also, also diabetogenic because of all these things. But in some pregnancies, there is a pre-programming. So genetically, they are more prone. So that's why diabetes is more common in a certain number of pregnancies, not in all pregnancies. But pregnancy itself is a diabetogenic.
Okay.
So you can give metformin or glibenclamide. What is the dose of metformin?
500 micrograms.
Micrograms.
500 milligrams.
You can start with 250 milligrams 8 hourly, or increase the dose to 500 milligrams 8 hourly. Up to 3 grams you can give. What are the disadvantages of metformin?
It travels through the placenta.
It causes hypoglycemia
in the child.
So hypoglycemic spells are more in the baby. Even with the glibenclamide also, that is. But glibenclamide is more dangerous than the metformin. Otherwise, both of them are very good drugs. If the sugar levels are not controlled even with metformin or glibenclamide, what will you do?
We'll shift to insulin.
You can shift to insulin, or along with the metformin, you can add insulin also. Okay.
Okay, ma'am.
What is the role of insulin?
It helps in glucose uptake, ma'am.
Okay, what are the different types of insulins available?
Rapid acting and intermediate acting insulins, ma'am.
Rapid acting, regular insulin,
intermediate,
and yes, long acting. What are the different types of rapid acting insulins? Very good.
Human is act rapid and isoflurane.
No, regular insulin, that we are telling regular insulin. Actrapid is a regular insulin, regular soluble insulin. Lispro and aspart are rapidly acting insulin. Intermediate acting is isoflurane. Long acting is? Very good. Glargine and Ketimer. So, how you give the regular insulin? We are usually using the regular insulin or rapidly acting insulins. How you administer? Your plan of administer?
Subcutaneously, insulin is injected.
How many times?
How many?
Times. This is three times with each with three major meals. You divided your diet into three major meals. So along with three major meals, just before the each meal, you administer the insulin. That is one way. What is the other way of your administration? Combination. You can add intermediate acting with rapid acting or short acting. So 70% NPH plus 30% regular insulin, or 75% NPH with 25% Lispro or aspart. So if you give a combination therapy, you can give 2/3 before breakfast and 1/3 pre dinner. Okay. Then also you can maintain the blood sugar at least you can do 5 times a day.
Okay, ma'am.
To achieve the euglycemic status in the patient. So how you calculate the dose of the insulin?
Based on the blood sugar levels.
Blood sugar levels and based on the gestational age also. In early weeks, the insulin requirement is little less. After 28 weeks, it increases. So minimum of 0.8 to 1 unit per kg per day. If she is a 60 kgs lady at 34 weeks, she may need 60 units per day. You can divide the dose. And depending upon the blood sugar, you can reduce the dose or increase the dose according to it. So why gestational diabetes is so important? Why you are maintaining the euglycemic levels, not hyperglycemic levels? So what are the complications in the first trimester, second trimester, and third trimester?
Complications, maternal and fetal complications are present. Maternal
complications. Here in the diabetes, fetal complications are more rather than the maternal complications. Okay?
Yes,
so in the first trimester, gestational diabetes or Bobati diabetes, what are the complications?
Abortions.
Yes, abortions.
Preterm labor.
No, first trimester. So what are the dangers of what are the fetal risks in the first trimester? Ah, very good. Congenital anomalies. Which type of anomalies are more common?
Neural tube defects and ventricular defects are
very good. So congenital cardiac anomalies and fetal neural tube defects are more common. So that's why HbA1c is very important in the overweight diabetes. If it is more than HbA1c is more than 9, so better go for termination of the pregnancy, because more than 10% of the babies are abnormal. So you may not detect the congenital anomalies before 10 weeks. At the time of pregnancy, if the HbA1c is more than 10 and blood sugars are more, then better go for termination, because at the time of organogenesis there is hyperglycemia. So this hyperglycemia is toxic to the organogenesis. That's why better go for termination. That's why in every pregnancy at the time of conception, her blood sugar must be in euglycemic status. Then only you ask her to go, you advise her conception. So these are the first trimester complications, abortions and congenital anomalies. So what are the other complications of the baby?
Other complications of polyhydramnios.
Polyhydramnios. So what are the risks with polyhydramnios?
Polyhydramnios, malpositions. Premature rupture of
membranes. Very good. Premature rupture of the membranes and preterm deliveries.
Placenta. Abruptio.
Placenta previa and abruptio. Polyhydramnios. Abruption is more common because of the sudden rupture of the membranes. Sudden abruption may occur, and also because of the large baby, large placenta. So placenta previa is also, that is maternal complication. So what are, so because of the hyperglycemia, one is polyhydramnios. Next, what are the other complications in the baby? Macrosomia.
Yes, maternal,
what will happen? Maternal hyperglycemia leads to fetal
fetal hyperglycemia,
hyperglycemia
and hyperinsulinemia occurs. So macrosomia of the baby.
So augmented fetal growth. So that's a muscle, bone, adipose tissue all will develop. So the BPD is more, abdominal circumference is bisacromial diameter is more. So because of the macrosomia, blood supply, oxygen supply to the baby may be decreased, so that it may cause stillbirths or intrauterine deaths. So macrosomia may lead to stillbirth or IUD. So these are the complications because of the macrosomia. What are the respiratory complications?
Respiratory distress syndrome.
Respiratory distress syndrome. What is the reason for respiratory distress syndrome?
Hyperinsulinemia causes a decrease in the level of cortisol, ma'am. And it leads to decreased production of surfactant.
Phosphatidylserine. That is surfactant. Delayed appearance of phosphatidylserine. So normal pregnancy, it appears at
12 weeks of gestation.
35 weeks.
35 weeks.
So respiratory distress is mainly due to premature birth, delayed appearance of the phosphatidylserine surfactant, and also delayed during cesarean section. There is a delayed resorption of the amniotic fluid in the lungs. That may also cause respiratory distress. Next, to stillbirth. Okay. What are the reasons of stillbirth?
Cephalopelvic disproportionation.
One reason is big baby, during delivery maybe difficulty, shoulder dystocia, delayed delivery and delayed grace, sometimes stillbirth. And also here there is a hyperglycemia, hyperinsulinemia in the baby leads to increased oxygen consumption, but the supply to the baby is less. That may also lead to stillbirth. Okay. So after delivery, what are the complications? One is respiratory distress, one is stillbirth.
Hyperbilirubinemia in newborn child.
Before that, neonatal hypoglycemia.
Yes, ma'am.
Why immediately after birth we will do the blood sugar levels and you encourage the feeding. As soon as baby born, you encourage the breastfeeding.
Yes,
what will happen due to persistence of hyperinsulinemia? So insulin will inhibit the release of the glucose. So
yes,
glycogenolysis and gluconeogenesis are delayed. And there may be increased glucose consumption. So that's why there may be hypoglycemia. If it is less than 35 milligrams, so we can say baby in hypoglycemia. So the baby, sometimes baby may land in convulsions also. So you immediately give glucose. What are the other complications in the baby? We are telling that hyperinsulinemia, okay? Hypercalcemia, hyperbilirubinemia, and fetal cardiomegaly. Yes, these are all the complications. So what are the complications in the mother?
During labor, she might get genital tract traumas.
So in the first trimester or second trimester or third trimester, if it is a overt diabetes, increased history of urinary tract infections. Okay?
Yes, ma'am.
Repeated vaginal candidiasis. If it is uncontrolled diabetes. So urinary tract infections and vaginal candidiasis, these are all common. So obstetric complications are polyhydramnios, placenta previa, abruptio placenta. So what are the other medical complications?
She might land into diabetic retinopathy and nephropathy, ketoacidosis.
So if it is a long standing diabetes, type 1 or type 2, then these complications, nephropathy, retinopathy, these ketoacidosis, these are all common. But in the gestational diabetes, they are not so common. So main common complication is preeclampsia.
Okay,
preeclampsia. What are the other complications? So these are the complications during the antenatal period. During labor, what are the complications?
Prolongation of labor, ma'am. Shoulder dystocia.
So prolonged
perineal injuries. Yes.
Prolonged labor may lead to intrapartum complications, like prolonged labor, PROM, prolonged labor, cephalopelvic disproportion, increased operative deliveries, like forceps deliveries, increased cesarean section rate. Almost cesarean section rate is almost 50%. What are the indications for cesarean section in diabetes?
Macrosomia, ma'am. Big baby.
If the baby.
Shoulder dystocia is an indication.
By different maneuvers, you can deliver the shoulder dystocia. Or you anticipate the shoulder dystocia when the baby is more than 4 kgs. Then you immediately go for cesarean section. Other comorbidities like preeclampsia. Twin gestation, sometimes type 1 or type 2 diabetes, there may be uncontrolled diabetes, may sometimes lead to IUGR also. Algoamias. In those cases also, better go for cesarean section. So, increased interventions of operative deliveries. So, these are causes of maternal morbidity during delivery. So, after delivery, what are the complications?
After delivery, PPH so, is the most common complication.
So, what is the reason here for the PPH?
Over distension of uterus might
be. Over distension. So, and also there is a prolonged labor. Causes over distance. So, atonic PPH is because of the operative delivery. So, forceps delivery, vaginal tears, cervical tears may occur because of the big baby. So, there may be traumatic PPH. Both can occur. Okay?
Okay.
What are the late complications?
Late complications is development of diabetes.
So late means immediate after delivery. So because of the diabetes, there may be puerperal sepsis, PRO, premature rupture of the membranes, prolonged labor, operative deliveries. These are all causes of some sepsis. So postpartum sepsis is immediate delivery complication, postnatal complications. How will you manage the blood sugars after delivery? In gestational diabetes, what will happen? What will happen in the diabetes? Once the placenta is outside, once the baby is there, what is the reason for the diabetes and pregnancy? Because of the placental hormones. Once the placenta is outside, so usually it will subside. Okay? We can monitor blood sugar levels first 48 hours. If they are normal, we can leave the patient and ask her to do the test after 6 weeks. Again, go for fasting blood sugar, postprandial blood sugar, or GTT, oral GTT. Okay, so long-term complications are
development of diabetes and infection.
So usually development of these GDM patients, 50% may go into diabetes mellitus type 2 after 5 years. So postnatal counseling is also important to the patient. Frequent checkups of the blood sugar levels, weight management, exercise. You must do proper counseling after the delivery. And the chances of diabetes in the offspring also more common. These babies may develop obesity and diabetes in future. So that's why early detection and management of the diabetes is very important. Okay. Now you ask Mansi to show the slides.
Yes, ma'am.
What is the definition of the diabetes, gestational diabetes?
Carbohydrate intolerance of variant variable severity, which is detected for the first time during the present pregnancy.
You can see the slide, no? You can able to see the
yes,
slide? You can read.
Yes, carbohydrate intolerance. Yes. Carbohydrate intolerance with recognition during pregnancy. Universal screening is necessary for the diagnosis and for prevention of future type 2 diabetes mellitus by taking proper care.
So that's why diagnosis of the proper care, pregnancy proper care, and also future avoiding the future diabetes mellitus. That's why recognition of the gestational diabetes is very important. Next one, next slide. Go one by one. Next slide. What is the pathogenesis of the GDM?
Altered insulin supply or secretion, increased insulin demand, increased insulin resistance. These changes are mediated by placental products. Implicated are placental progesterone, human chorionic somatomammotropin, placental lactogen, resulting in temporary beta cell secretory.
Next.
These changes get reversed after delivery, but in 50% of patients develop type 2 diabetes mellitus at a later date, and their offsprings are also at risk for diabetes type 2. Early life programming in these patients, that is, they are genetically prone, evidenced by insulin resistance, lower ability to produce insulin.
So every patient is, every pregnant lady is diabetogenic, but in some patients only GDM present. Why? Because of the early life programming in these patients. These patients are insulin resistance is more, and their ability to secretion of the insulin is very less. Because of these two reasons, there is a diabetes. Next slide.
Indications for screening of patients at high risk of for GDM: family history of diabetes mellitus, glucose in second fasting sample of urine, history of unexplained perinatal loss, history of large for gestational age infant, history of congenitally malformed infant, maternal obesity, age more than 30 years, any BOH,
history of history.
Bad obstetrics.
What is the importance? What is the polycystic ovarian disease? What is the importance of glycosuria? Make glycosuria short note. Yes. Mark's question.
Yes, glycosuria is physiological in pregnancy, ma'am. Because why? The threshold glucose blood glucose level is reduced in pregnancy,
so reabsorption is less. Even though blood sugar is less than 180, also there is a excretion of the glucose in the urine, glycosuria. So it's a physiological. When it is pathological. If it is persisting in the second trimester also, and okay. Also fasting, second sample of the fasting urine also containing the sugar, and also previous history of big baby, and the previous pregnancy, there is a history of gestational diabetes, then screening is very important. That's why glycosuria in pregnancy also very important. Next slide.
Weight categories and BMI. Underweight is less than 18.5. Normal is 18.5 to 24.9. Overweight is 25 to 29.9. Obesity is more than 30. Class 1 obesity is 30 to 34.9. Class 2 is 35 to 39.9. Class 3 is more than 40 or more than 35 with comorbidity.
Comorbidities like renal disease, hypertension, and all. Next.
Adverse outcomes of pregnancy. Preeclampsia, gestational hypertension, overweight, obesity, excessive fetal growth, fetal macrosomia, congenital malformations, spontaneous abortions, increased incidence of induction of labor. Cesarean delivery.
Okay, next. Continuous. continuation. Urinary tract, repeated urinary tract infection.
Urinary tract infection, intrapartum, postpartum, and postoperative infections, intrapartum, postpartum, and postoperative hemorrhage, thromboembolism, internal morbidity and mortality, perinatal morbidity and mortality.
So these are all adverse outcomes. Next.
Fetal risks in gestational diabetes and diabetes mellitus, congenital anomalies, macrosomia, respiratory distress syndrome, stillbirth, neonatal hypoglycemia, hypocalcemia, hyperbilirubinemia.
Okay, next.
Diagnostic criteria for GDM with 75 grams of glucose load according to IADPSG, fasting the lecture 92 milligram per deciliter, first 180 milligram per deciliter, second hour 153 milligram per deciliter. According to WHO and DIPSI, two hour blood sugar levels 140 milligram per deciliter in India. 140 milligram per deciliter in India, DIPSI is followed.
So what are the advantages of DIPSI? Why DIPSI is more preferable than the other tests?
Patient need not be in fast.
So in the pregnancy it is very difficult. If you ask her to come fasting, she may faint. So she can come with a full stomach also. In respect of the last meal. Next, it is a single step test. Time consumption is less. So she need not wait for 4 hours, 5 hours. She can take glucose and go away, go for other tests. Meanwhile, she can go for other blood tests and all. And then again, she can come back after 2 hours and we can take the blood sample. So there is three pokes are not necessary. Fasting, first hour, second hour. So it is very convenient and it's also cost effective. Three times the sugar means the cost is more. Here the cost is less. So because for Indian women, DIPSI is more favorable because of all these advantages. Next.
Advantages of DIPSI. No need to fast. Least disturbance in pregnant women. Routine activities in single test. Serves both as screening and diagnostic procedure. Cost effective, so repeatedly can be done. This is single step procedure and is recommended by WHO and approved by Ministry of Health.
Government of India.
Yes.
Next.
When to do screening. In all pregnant women at 24 to 28 weeks of gestation, better do it in first antenatal visit to avoid the missing the pre-gestational diabetes. So that we can prevent adverse pregnancy complications like PROM, preterm labor, and polyhydramnios.
Okay, next.
Chances of detection of GDM at or less than 16 weeks 12.3%, 17 to 23 weeks 22.4%, more than 22 weeks 61.3%.
So that's why you can miss these 40%. That is why at the time of first antenatal visit, better to do the. Otherwise, if you miss at the first antenatal visit, you can do at 24 to 28 weeks or 16 weeks. So that we can detect more number of cases. Next slide.
Cutoff levels for diagnosis of GDM. DIPSI 140 milligram percent. IADPSG. FBS is 90 less than 92. 1 hour is 180 mg per dl. Second hour 153. Second hour 153 mg per dl. If fasting blood sugar is more than 92 and less than 126, it indicates GDM. If fasting blood sugar is more than 126 and HbA1c is 6.5 in early weeks, it suggests over diabetes mellitus.
Next.
Modes of management, MNT, medical nutritional therapy, oral hypoglycemic agents, and insulin. glycemic targets in management in DDM pre-meal is 80 to 90, post-meal 1 hour is 130 to 140, 2 hours post-meal is 100 to 120, whereas HbA1c level is less than 5.3. In pre-gestational diabetes mellitus, pre-meal 90, post-meal 1 hour is 140, and post-meal 2 hours is 120. Whereas HbA1c levels is less than 6 months.
So for the convenience sake, you can remember fasting blood sugar 90, less than 90, and postprandial blood sugar less than 120, and HbA1c is less than 6. You can remember like this, okay? Next slide.
Medical nutritional therapy, carbohydrate control meal plan that promotes adequate nutrition, weight gain, and a good glycemic status in pregnancy. Total of 1800 to 2400 kilocalories per day. Carbohydrate is 50%, protein is 20%, fat is 30%.
Okay.
MNT conditions for ideal weight, 30 kilocalories per kg per day. Overweight is 24 kilocalories per kg per day. Obese women 12 to 15 kilocalories per kg per day. Meal is divided into 3 major meals, each divided into 2 portions plus 3 snacks, so that the total calorie is divided into 9 portions. Wait for 2 weeks to maintain fasting blood sugar of 90 milligram per deciliter and PPBS of
120. So if there is no proper maintenance, you can shift to
Oral hypoglycemic or insulin.
Okay. Next slide.
Metformin Bignite, 500 milligram TID up to 3 grams. Glyburide sulfonylurea, 2.5 milligrams, one dose up to 10 milligrams. Rapid acting insulin, Lispro, insulin aspart, short acting regular soluble insulin, intermediate are isoflex, long acting insulin, Etimer, insulin. Regular or rapid acting insulins can be given with all 3 major meals. Patient with fasting hyperglycemia needs additional NPH or Detemer at bedtime.
Okay.
Combinations like 70% plus 30% regular, 75% NPH and 25% Lispro, 50% NPH and 50% Lispro, these can be given. 2/3 of total dose before bed.
And 1/3 before dinner, pre-dinner.
And 1/3 pre-dinner. Total daily dose can be calculated as 0.8 to 1 unit per kg per day. This varies according to the blood sugar levels of the patient.
Blood sugar levels and gestational age also.
Okay, gestational age.
Next slide.
Preconceptional counseling. In all patients who are at high risk for DDM or already having diabetes, need counseling. Explain regarding congenital anomalies. To avoid unplanned pregnancy, to avoid diabetes-related complications, to evaluate the drugs used by the patient and switch over to safer drugs, choosing good contraception to avoid pregnancy with poor glycemic control.
And also supplementation of the folic acid, vitamin D, these are also important before conception, preconception itself. Because in the high risk patients, all you counsel the patient before planning the pregnancy. So you can tell all these things, why counseling is necessary. Sometimes some antihypertensive drugs also contraindicated during pregnancy. Along with diabetes, if she is having hypertension also, you switch over the hypoglycemic agents and also antihypertensives. You change the drugs, then only you advise her to conceive.
Okay.
Next slide. Any slides? Any more? Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
So, gestational diabetes, in what way it is important? Clinically, it is important. Theoretically, it is important. Okay?
Yes, ma'am.
They can ask a 34 weeks primary gravida with blood sugars. Like your case, 150 milligrams with 34 weeks and cephalic presentation. For antenatal checkup. Have you managed?
Yes, ma'am.
Have you detect and have you managed these patients? What are the investigations? So, you can go through the slides and go and read in the textbook. Okay?
Okay, ma'am.
Okay.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.